Chapter 156, The War, Aura Headquarters, Monday the 8th of January, 1979. "Please let me come with you," was the last thing Sirius said as Remus left the flat early on Monday morning. "I'll be fine," Remus shook his head, trying to give Sirius a reassuring smile. He didn't say what he was thinking, which was, how would that look? It was bad enough he'd been summoned to Moody's actual office in the Ministry. What would he think if Remus brought his boyfriend along for moral support? Still, Remus had to admit that he had a difficult time leaving their cosy little home that morning. He'd barely left the bedroom since they'd returned from the funeral, let alone got dressed or left the flat. To go to the Ministry, he had to wear full robes for the first time since school, which helped a little bit, at least he'd be able to blend in. The visitor's entrance for the Ministry of Magic was about 20 minutes' walk from Soho, and Remus found the early morning stroll more pleasant than he'd expected. It was a crisp, cold January day, and his breath turned white in the winter air. Peter was there to meet him. "Hiya, Mooney." Wormtail smiled up at him, giving him an awkward pat on the arm. "How are you holding up?"
"Oh, you know," Remus shrugged. Grief was a funny thing. He never knew if he was doing it right.
"Looking forward to Saturday?"
"Yeah, me too."
The full moon was due on the 13th. So far, since Hogwarts, the Marauders had got away with apparating, Peter sidelonged, to the most remote places possible and transforming there. So far, they'd been to the Brecon Beacons, the Outer Hebrides, Dartmoor, and the Forest of Dean. No one in the Order had brought it up yet, though Remus supposed that they all assumed he was registered. Peter and Remus entered the Ministry via a telephone box. Peter needed to be there, because after Remus had stated his business, a small silver visitor's badge dropped out of the telephone slot. Wormtail picked it up quickly and muttered an incantation to turn it into tin, before giving it to Remus. They descended into the Ministry atrium, which was heaving with activity. It was an enormous hall, bigger than Gringotts, with rows of fireplaces lining the walls. Green lights flashed intermittently from each hearth as wizards and witches arrived for work. Peter led Remus through the security stand, where his wand was weighed by a mean-spirited wizard with a long beard. Remus was incredibly grateful to have a friend with him, and secretly quite glad it was quiet, genial Peter, rather than Sirius, who had a tendency to get a bit overprotective of Remus when it came to the wizarding community. Next, they moved through to another hall with a set of lifts, and entered the nearest one.
"You're on level 2, Peter explained chirpily. "I'm with the Flu Network Authority on 4. Do you need me to show you where the Aura's office is?"
Remus thought he would quite like Peter's help, if only Peter wasn't so clearly enjoying having the upper hand.
"No," he smiled. "I'll manage. Cheers, mate."
Peter gave him a kind smile as he left the lift. Remus nodded back, and the door slid closed. Soon enough, the tannoy announced, "Level 2, Department of Magical Law Enforcement, including the Improper Use of Magic Office, Aura Headquarters, and the Wizgamot Administration Services." Remus shuffled his way out of the lift and onto the corridor. The lift doors closed behind him with a ping, and Remus stood there for a few moments, blindsided. It was a very busy hallway, wizards and witches striding up and down, some deep in conversation, others hastily scribbling down notes on scraps of parchment, and some of them muttering to themselves. Over his head, purple paper airplanes zoomed back and forth, fluttering into the office doors which lined the corridor. He wished he hadn't been so proud now, and asked Peter to walk him to the right office. There had to be a sign somewhere.
"Lupin!"
A loud and familiar voice boomed. Remus turned around with some relief and smiled, seeing Ferox barrelling towards him, hand raised in salutation.
"Hi,"
he said.
"Lost! Come with me."
Remus followed Ferox along the hallway, past office after office, until they reached an elaborate door with a carved wooden frame.
"Nervous?"
Ferox glanced at him sideways. Remus looked back.
"Is it that obvious?" Ferox laughed and clapped him on the shoulder. I'd be concerned if you weren't. Come on now, it's only Moody.
He pushed the door open with one big hand, the other still on Remus's shoulder, as if to stop him from running away. As a child, Remus had had some experience with Muggle law enforcement, only ever for silly things like running away from the home or being caught causing a disturbance, which usually meant that he was just somewhere public and other people would prefer him not to be. The police were extra rough with you once they clocked you're a St. Edmund's boy. They'd call you things and shove you in their car, or else give off thinly veiled threats of physical violence if you didn't do as you were told. As a result, Remus had never felt that comfortable around authority figures, even if he was a posh boy nowadays. He wasn't sure exactly how similar the auras were to the Muggle police. He'd only met Moody, Frank and Alice so far. Moody was completely terrifying, but Remus had known him long enough now that he was used to him. Alice and Frank were very nice, very earnest people, but then they didn't know what he really was. The inside of the office was very busy, with rows of desks divided into cubicles. There were posters of criminals, magically enchanted maps and printed lists on notice boards around the walls, and memos whizzing back and forth. But the most striking thing about it for Remus was the incredibly concentrated scent of strong magic, and dark magic too. Ferox, hand still on Remus's shoulder, steered him towards a desk near the back corner, which had the best vantage point to the rest of the chaotic office. Moody's desk and the shelves around it were cluttered with weird and wonderful magical devices, whirring telescopes, glowing crystals, strange humming orbs. Moody himself was bent over a map. Forgetting his nerves, Remus peered over his shoulder to look. He'd never got over his interest in cartography, and Moody barked.
"Never sneak up on an aura, Lupin!"
Remus jumped back, alarmed, and Moody turned to face him, grinning, his mad eye swiveling sickly in its socket.
"Leo."
Moody reached out and shook hands with Ferox, then with Remus.
"Glad to see you nice and punctual. Have a seat."
He gestured at the long velvet-covered seat against the wall of his cubicle, which hadn't been there a moment ago. Remus and Ferox sat down as Moody cast a spell, which muted the noise around them, creating a bubble of peace around his desk, and was not dissimilar to James and Sirius's silencing charms. Remus was relieved by the quiet, but Moody's spell had done nothing to mitigate the overwhelming scent of power which filled his nostrils, swam down his throat and filled up his chest with glorious, rich, syrupy magic. He tried to relax, to let it find its place in him rather than fighting it, but he felt ever so slightly drunk with it all the same.
"Once again, Lupin,"
Moody said gruffly, sitting down in his office chair, which looked like a plush green leather armchair, but swiveled on one stern.
"I was sorry to hear about your loss. I didn't know Hope myself, but..."
"That's okay,"
Remus said quickly.
I barely knew her either."
He was keen to keep his mother out of any conversation he had today. He hadn't the strength for two things at once. And if Moody had a mission for him, then that had to be his main concern. Moody, who was either an excellent legerdemain or simply extremely astute and empathetic, nodded manfully and continued.
"Straight to business, then," he said. "Good chap."
He swiveled slightly in his chair to pick up the map he'd been looking at, and handed it to Remus. Remus took it eagerly and looked. It was a map of Britain and Ireland, but not like ones he had seen before. There were no roads marked, no towns or cities, only the woodland areas, marked in mossy green splodges of ink. Some of these splodges seemed to shimmer and twinkle, as if there were stars hiding beneath the tree branches.
"Got that from the Control of Magical Creatures office," Moody explained. "Thanks to Ferox here. Know what it is, lad?"
"It's..."
Remus pored over it.
It's all the forests with magic in it. Or magical creatures."
"Exactly."
Moody nodded, looking very pleased with himself.
We've noticed that most of the werewolf sightings of the past few years have been in enchanted woodland, forests with a denser population of magical creatures. Now, that could just mean they're keeping their ears to the ground for you know who, or that there are other creatures working with them.
Or because the scent of all that natural magic is just too good to resist, Remus thought, his own blood fizzing like champagne just from the 20 or so powerful wizards nearby. He didn't say this, of course, for his own sake.
And for the last couple of full moons, there's been a lot of activity here.
Moody pointed a stubby, scarred finger at a point on the map, somewhere in the Midlands.
Why are you telling me now?
Remus asked.
If you've been following them for months.
It's time,
Moody said, fixing him with a hard stare, one blue eye, one brown.
Greyback's in the country for the first time since the 60s. It's been confirmed.
Oh.
Remus pursed his lips to quell the rage inside him, rearing up like a cobra, showing its teeth. Where is he? Take me to him now. Right now.
Right.
Last time you made contact, you came back with some good information,
Moody continued.
Those who want to join Greyback need to transform with the pack 3 times. That right?
Remus nodded. He wanted to stand up and pace or do something physical, but he couldn't afford for either Ferox or Moody to know that there was anything wrong.
The next full moon is on Saturday.
Remus nodded. He looked at Ferox, then Moody again.
You want me to go already? To start to...
Just for the moons, Ferox said, his voice calming. Just until they trust you.
But once they trust me,
Remus said, looking at his hands.
Then I need to meet him, right?
Let's see how things go,
Moody said, choosing his words carefully.
We've 3 months to plan for that.
Okay.
Remus didn't know what else to say. His head was full and his nerves were raw and he felt almost ready to explode. But for some weird reason he just sat there like a polite schoolboy, listening to Moody lay out the plan. He was given a lot of rules. He would have to go alone. He could take his wand, but nothing else. He could tell nobody, not even the other members of the Order. Not even his best friends. Ferox began suggesting things Remus could say or do to get the pack to trust him. But Remus ignored him. He knew what to do.
I'll walk you out, shall I, Lupin?
Ferox said finally, with a note of paternal kindness.
Thanks,
Remus said, standing up quickly.
You're a man of few words, Lupin,
Moody said, standing up too, holding out his hand once more for Remus to shake.
But I have every faith in you. I'll send the coordinates before Saturday. Make sure you're at home to receive them.
Remus nodded blankly, shaking the proffered hand. Just as he'd guided him in, Ferox led Remus back out of the Aura headquarters.
All right there, fella?
Ferox asked, once they were clear of the doors. The corridor was a bit quieter than it had been at 9 o'clock.
Yes, fine.
If there's anything you think you need, if you want me to just ask Moody for something that will help, then you can just...
How will it help?
Remus asked, suddenly, stopping in the middle of the hallway. He twitched his thumb and cast Muffliato without any effort at all. Ferox blinked, surprised.
How will what help?
Me. Meeting Greyback. I've met 3 members of his pack now, and it's only made things worse each time.
That's not true. You've given us some extremely valuable information.
If I have,
Remus said.
Then I want to know what you're using it for.
To win the war, Remus.
Ferox shook his head.
When I met Castor last year,
Remus said, his voice very low, but more out of anger than a desire to be discreet.
He told me, in no uncertain terms, that they were planning an attack. I told Dumbledore, and what happened? Nothing. The attack went ahead. So I'll ask again. If I'm gathering information for the Order, if I'm risking my life to do it, then I want to know what for. It's obviously not to save lives.
Remus, that was an incredibly complicated situation.
Well, explain it.
We couldn't act. We couldn't let the werewolves know you were telling Dumbledore anything. We had to preserve your connection with them.
What?
Remus stared at him.
People died. People had their whole lives ruined. Because of me.
You can't think about it that way.
How would you think about it? I trusted him. I thought I was doing the right thing.
Remus, calm down.
Remus realised that he couldn't.
He wished he could apparate right there and then, but nothing happened when he tried, so he marched towards the lift instead.
Don't follow me,
he growled at Ferox, who held the doors open, stopping him from leaving.
You need to get your head straight, kid,
Ferox said very seriously.
This is war. It's not noble, and it's not always about saving lives. You need to get used to that in time for Saturday.
Don't worry.
Remus turned his head, glaring at the panel of buttons. The doors began to slide shut, grinding loudly as Remus tested his magical strength against Ferox's physical muscle.
I'll be ready.
The doors shut, Ferox snatching his fingers clear at the very last second, and Remus began to move up, back towards the real world. Remus had barely stepped out of the visitor's entrance phone box, and he was standing before his own front door. He'd stored all of that leftover magic up like a battery, and he only needed to have the slightest want, and the magic did the rest. He remembered the curse Snape had thrown at James, which he'd deflected on the last day of school. It would be a useful skill, if only he could depend on it. Not only was he full of magic, but his temper had reached boiling point now that he was home. It was a peculiar feeling, similar to the moments before transforming, right before the mind-numbing pain kicked in. A howling, grasping animal longing. God, he needed...
Sirius!
He burst through the door, yelling. No luck, the flat was empty. Remus gave a frustrated growl and kicked the wall, knocking a hole through the plasterboard.
Fuck, he muttered. Sirius, come here.
He pressed his palm against the top of the wall and forced some magic out. The hole at the base of the wall closed over at once, thank goodness. It wasn't enough. He had more. He needed to vent it. A release valve. He pulled off his robes and then his jumper, tossing them onto the couch, pacing the room in his thin t-shirt and trousers. He could go for a run. He could apparate to the Lake District for a few hours and just run around like a madman. He could turn the wall into sponge and start punching it until he'd run out of energy. He could drink himself into oblivion, as long as he did something.
Mooney!
The front door opened, and there was Sirius.
You're here!
Yeah, weirdest thing.
Sirius closed the door behind him. He smelt of petrol and motor oil and leather.
Oh, that would do it. I was working on the bike up the road, and then, I don't know, I could have sworn I heard your voice. But if you only just got back, then it couldn't have been.
Remus couldn't take it anymore. He crossed the room in two strides and pushed Sirius up against the door, kissing him hard. Sirius kissed him back, eager to please as always. Remus pressed harder, taking Sirius's lovely white wrists smeared with oil, holding them and pushing a knee between his legs. He began to kiss down Sirius's neck, nipping at the soft flesh there, and Sirius gasped.
Bloody hell, are you all right?
Mm-hmm,
Remus said.
I just want to...
Sirius moved his hips slightly, pressing into Remus. It felt like electricity, and Remus almost lost control altogether, squeezing Sirius's wrists, slamming his eyes shut as he fought to hang on. He wasn't the only one who felt it.
Fuck!
Sirius panted, helpless in Remus's grip.
Was that you? You feel what's...
magic,
Remus managed to stammer, eyes still closed, rolling his forehead against Cirrus's shoulder dizzily.
There was so much, and I just,
And suddenly it was Cirrus who was in control. He turned the tables, and now he was pulling Remus to the bedroom. And thank God the flat was small, and thank God there was no need anymore for silencing charms or secrecy, because there was simply not the time.
Need you,
Cirrus was saying incoherently, pulling off his t-shirt, then tugging at Remus's, his black greasy fingerprints getting everywhere.
Need to feel you, Remus.
Remus, intoxicated, could only say yes. Whatever he was feeling, he knew Sirius could feel it too as he pushed the magic outwards, filling the room with it, igniting every touch. Remus groaned as their bare skin finally met and Sirius closed his eyes and shuddered, grasping fingers and gritted teeth. Any sense of concern or shame was obliterated by the heat erupting between them. Remus gave in and thought of nothing else as he selfishly arced against Sirius, who kept feverishly whispering, "Moony, Moony, Moony," over and over. Their fierce rhythm increased as they began to tense, gasping as the world exploded. For a few blissful seconds, everything went white. They had to go twice more before Cirrus was satisfied, and Remus still felt like he could run a marathon.
"If you're planning to visit the Aura's office again," Cirrus replied hoarsely, "I'm going to need some warning."
"Sorry,"
Remus started, but Cirrus clapped a hand over his mouth, grinning.
"Don't you dare apologize. I mean, fucking hell."
Remus laughed, pulling his hand away. He waved a hand at the window lazily, and it slid open, letting cool winter air in.
"Wow."
Cirrus raised his eyebrows.
"How long does that last?"
"It's going away,"
Remus said, closing his eyes. It was. He could feel his heart slowing down, his muscles relaxing.
"Last time, Snape's curse drained it, so I suppose any kind of counter magic works."
"Well, I'd prefer this to cursing you."
Cirrus rolled over and stroked Remus's bare hip. Remus murmured in agreement, eyes still closed.
"So," Cirrus said, his hand still now, his voice more solemn. "It either went really well or really badly at the Ministry."
"Both."
Remus flung his arms over his face.
"Do we have to talk about it?"
"Yeah, I think we do."
Remus sighed heavily. He sat up, reaching for his cigarettes.
"Greyback's in England,"
he started. Sirius sat up at once, frowning. He took a cigarette from the box Remus held out, placed it between his lips, lit it, and looked at Remus very seriously.
"Tell me everything."
And Remus did. Chapter 157, The War, The Pack. Saturday, the 13th of January, 1979. First moon.
"I hate this," Sirius said, chain-smoking.
"I know you do,"
Remus replied. He rubbed his temples. He was getting a headache, not uncommon to the ones on a full moon.
"No, I mean, I really hate this."
Sirius puffed, staring out of the window. He stood there, one arm folded across his narrow waist, other arm crooked at the elbow so that he could hold the cigarette to his lips. He had to keep stretching up on his tiptoes to blow the smoke out of the gap in the window. It was too cold to open it all the way. Every time he reached up,
His t-shirt rode up almost to his belly button, displaying soft skin and a line of fine dark hair. Remus lay on the couch, a cold flannel on his forehead, watching Sirius inhale, stretch, puff. Lovely, lovely creature. How had Remus ever got so lucky?
It's bloody mental, sending you on your own. Why can't I go with you? I could go as Padfoot.
No,
Remus sighed.
You still smell human. They'd tear you apart.
What if they tear you apart?
Sirius turned sharply. He looked distraught. His cheeks were pink, which was incredible for he of the porcelain complexion.
Me?
Remus snorted, trying to sound careless.
Greyback's prodigal son? Not likely.
What's a prodigal son?
Oh, right, just means I'm going to get a warm welcome. Gaius said not to hurt me. Livia called me her brother.
Could I come with you for a bit? Just before anyone else shows up?
It's not safe, Padfoot,
Remus said gently. Sirius stubbed out his cigarette angrily on the windowsill. Remus wished he'd stopped doing that. They would need to repaint it soon. But now was not the time to scold him.
Why don't you go to the Potters?
He suggested.
Don't spend the night here by yourself.
I don't care where I spend the night. Sirius flung himself into the armchair.
Well, I do,
Remus tutted.
I need to know where to go after the moon's down.
Oh, shit, yeah.
Sirius sat up, sweeping his hair back. Okay, I'll go to the Potters. Then if you need any patching up, Euphemia will be on hand.
No, fuck. What if you can't apparate? What if you...
I'll send a Patronus.
But if you're not strong enough...
I will be,
Remus replied simply. He was going to an enchanted forest, based on the coordinates Moody had sent. And even if there was only half the magic there that there was in the Forbidden Forest, then Remus foresaw no problem getting himself out, unless someone with equal strength tried to stop him. But he was trying not to think about that. A faint chiming sound echoed through the walls. They hadn't met their neighbours properly, only shyly waved hellos in the hall. But they knew they had a grandfather clock, because it went off every hour and was so loud they could hear it in their living room. It was 4 o'clock, and the depths of winter, which meant sundown was imminent. Remus sat up slowly, tossing aside the flannel. His back ached, early pangs telling him the moon was on its way.
I'd better start going,
he said. Sirius stared at him, stricken. Remus tutted, getting up. He went over and kissed Sirius's forehead.
Go to the Potters. I'll be fine. Honestly, you go on missions all the time.
Not like this. It's defensive stuff, guard duty, carrying messages, not...
Someone has to do it,
Remus shrugged.
I'd rather it was me.
He thought of Danny again and flinched, shaking his head, trying to rid himself of the negative memory. It kept coming up, ever since Remus had learnt the truth about why Danny had been turned. God, the McKinnons had every reason to hate Remus. He put his shoes on, tying the laces carefully, though he knew he'd only have to take them off again soon. He wore muggle clothes. This had been Ferox's suggestion. The werewolves had no idea where Remus was living, or how he was living. If Remus could convince them he'd been shunned by the wizarding world, then all the better. They hugged at the door, Remus's skin already burning up. Sirius clinging to him so tightly, Remus thought he'd have to take him with him after all.
I love you,
Sirius said into his shoulder. They hadn't said it since Hope's funeral, but Remus had no trouble at all responding instantly.
I love you too. He'll be fine. I'll see you soon, I promise.
And then he left, and he apparated. And when Remus opened his eyes, he was very much alone. He was somewhere in Derbyshire, at least he thought so. It was rapidly growing dark, and the thick forest canopy made it darker still. The night air was very cold and clean, but Remus was already too warm, and began to strip down at once. He was alone, after all. There was no need to be shy. Except he was not alone, not completely.
This was definitely a magical forest. He could taste it on the breeze, hear it in the rustling of the wintry tree branches. The moon began to rise, and Remus felt his body start to change. He braced himself against an oak, clawing at the bark with his nails, toes curling in the mouldy leaf litter. The trees seemed to empathize. The earth rose up to meet him, damp ground cooling his feverish skin. Owls and foxes and bats and all the nocturnal creatures of the woodland crying out as he screamed and his skin burst open and his bones cracked and his teeth sharpened until he was no longer Remus, and he howled along with them. The wolf snarled, whipping its tail. It did not know where it was or why it was alone. Where were the others? Where was the black one? It sniffed the air, sensing something nearby. It threw back its head and howled once more, singing to the moon. For the first time in its life, the wolf did not sing alone. A cacophony of beautiful voices joined in, answering, and he ran towards them at full pelt. With every beat of its wolfish heart, it panted, "Home, home, I am home." Sunday, the 14th of January, 1979. Coughing and spluttering, Remus returned to his senses. He came back piece by piece, confused and sore and exhausted. He opened his eyes and squinted at the cold yellow morning sun flashing at him through bare branches. All around him, the sounds of others waking up, some broken sobs, rough gasps, and female laughter. Their scent was so delicious, so safe, and so comforting. Remus propped himself up on his elbows, dead leaves sticking to his mushroom clammy skin. He had a long claw mark along his right thigh, three stripes oozing blood. Around him, six or seven others lay naked on the forest floor, slowly coming around. "Brother!" A familiar cackle sounded out. Remus twisted around to see Livia crawling towards him on all fours, her hips swaying, a deranged grin on her face. In the daylight, her tattoos looked like animal markings. They covered every inch of her scrawny body in great sweeping spirals. "I knew you would come!" She knelt at his feet, and he tried to draw his knees up away from her, but she shot out a hand and grabbed his ankle. "You were beautiful, Remus Lupin. Beautiful," she purred, leaning forward, her hand moving up his leg.
"Get off me, Livia,"
he growled, trying to kick at her, but she held him fast. "Shh," she said playfully, leaning over even further, her hand moving even closer.
"Just relax, my love, my darling brother."
She stretched out her hand and ran three splayed fingers down the cuts on his leg. It felt weird. His whole body seemed to tingle and quiver. He felt warm and worryingly on the verge of arousal. He did pull away then, scuttling backwards on all fours like a crab. Livia laughed at him, holding up her three bloody fingertips, then sucking them into her mouth one by one, grinning and murmuring with pleasure. Disturbed, he stood up quickly, finding that whatever Livia had done had healed the wound. He was left only with a silvery scar. The others were up too, and closing in on him, walking towards Remus through the trees, eyes burning with curiosity, sniffing at the air. Some of them were cut or scratched, but they each healed each other, just by touching and channeling the natural magic which surrounded them. Many of them had shaved heads, and the beginnings of the same tattoos Livia had. Others were perhaps more recent additions, and had longer hair, clearer skin. Remus wanted to summon his clothes, and ideally his wand too, but it seemed a bit rude when everyone else was stark as two. Besides, he wasn't cold, at least not yet. He wasn't frightened either, which seemed strange. He looked around at the faces, and still that voice deep within him said, "Pack, pack, home."
"Gaius,"
Livia said, suddenly standing up. Gaius was at her side in an instant. He smiled at Remus, licking his lips.
"Welcome, brother. Welcome, brother,"
the others echoed,
one after another, like a peal of bells. Remus felt a surge of adrenaline, of strong, undeniable connection.
"We're so glad you could join us," Gaius said.
Livia turned to him and began to lick his wounds, as if it was the most natural thing in the world. Castor was there too, but he hung back. Since Remus had last met him, Castor had received a wound which slashed his face, a long split across the nose. It was healed over, but it ruined his once beautiful face. Remus remembered himself and found his voice.
"I've had enough," he said, raising his chin. "I've had enough of the humans. I want to see what else there is."
Gaius's grin widened, and Livia looked up too, blood on her lips and teeth.
"Our father will be so pleased," they said in unison. "So pleased," repeated the group.
"I want to meet him," Remus said. "Will you tell him that?"
"In time, Remus Lupin," Livia and Gaius said. "In time."
Something was happening, though. The pack was retreating. They walked away back into the trees, the bush, fading into the landscape like the predators they were. Remus felt a tug in his chest. He wanted to follow them. He didn't want to lose their company yet.
"Where are you going?"
he asked Livia, as she too began to back away.
"We will see you next month, Remus Lupin," she said, her face softening somewhat.
She looked almost kind, if you ignored the blood drying at the corners of her mouth.
"It is not long to wait."
"But I..."
They both turned and did not look back. Now Remus started feeling cold. The chill seemed to begin inside him and work its way out. He felt a horrible, empty loneliness that hadn't been there before. Their scent was gone, their familiarity, the safety they represented.
"Jesus Christ, Mooney," he hissed at himself. "Sort yourself out, you're not really one of them."
He summoned his clothes quickly and held his wand tight. It felt weird. Much easier to simply summon the strength in his own body, at his very fingertips. No need for a silly stick. He frowned. He did not feel himself. Best to apparate back to the Potters quickly, before he turned completely feral. He apparated to the back door, and knocked weakly on the glass of the French windows. He felt much more tired by then, perhaps the effort of apparition, or just being away from the forest and back in mundanity. Mrs. Potter was already in the kitchen, and came over at once, opening the doors. She beamed at him with creased and wrinkled eyes.
"Remus, dear,"
she said, her voice very quiet, the others must still be sleeping.
"Oh, I'd better ask you something. Let me see. Oh, I'm no good at this. Ah, where did you and the boys go on holiday before your 7th year?"
"Como,"
Remus replied promptly, grateful to be reminded of that wonderful summer.
"Near Truro."
"Lovely."
She opened the door.
"Now, are you all right? Anything hurt?"
"No, I'm fine,"
he said, stepping into the kitchen, extending his arms as if to prove his good health to her. Oh God, now he was in the house he could smell Sirius, and everything in him wanted to seek him out at once.
"Lovely," Mrs. Potter smiled tiredly. "Well then, I think I'll go to bed. It's hours until breakfast. The boys are sleeping. Sirius is in his room, but if you wanted a bit of peace and quiet, I've made up the spare bed too."
"Thanks, Mrs. Potter,"
Remus said, practically running up the stairs to the bedroom Sirius was in. He remembered himself just before slamming the door open, and instead pushed it gently, peering inside. It was quite dark, the heavy curtains drawn over the early sunrise.
"Are you awake?"
he whispered redundantly, because he knew that he was.
"Mooney!"
Sirius sat up immediately. Remus hurried over to the bed, hanging back at the last moment, because, no, he wasn't a wolf now, he was human, and he had to act it.
Are you okay?
Yes, he nodded. It was fine. It was nothing. We just hunted.
Hunted? Sirius's eyes widened.
Rabbits,
Remus clarified. He could still taste the gammy flesh between his teeth. His stomach flipped, and he grew warm once more.
Honestly, it was fine. Easy.
I was so worried about you, I didn't even sleep. Don't you want to get in? He pulled back the covers. Remus shifted, still standing.
I'm a bit on edge.
Sirius frowned, confused. Remus cleared his throat.
You know, like the other day.
Oh. Sirius reached out and touched Remus's arm lightly. He bit his lip, shivering delightfully, getting a taste of the same feeling. So you are, He reached out and put his hands on Remus's hips, curling his fingers in under the waistband of his jeans. Sirius tugged him towards him. That's okay. We can sleep later. They did sleep later, both of them, and thankfully James and Lily and the Potters left them undisturbed. When they woke up at 5 o'clock the next evening, Remus felt like the worst guest in the world. Though, of course, Sirius was perfectly at home. Remus tried to explain the night's events to Sirius, but there were things he couldn't help glossing over. Livia healing him in that intimate way. The desire he'd had to stay to follow them. He wasn't lying. He was being as honest as he thought was safe. Later, he told Moody and Ferox an even more censored version. They didn't ask for much detail, to be fair, and Remus didn't see why he should give them everything. He was keen to keep the other werewolves' identities private for as long as he realistically could, and for now they were only interested in Greyback. As for Remus, he was the closest he'd ever been to the thing he'd wanted ever since he was a child. He was going to meet the man who destroyed his life, and he was going to kill him. Sunday, the 11th of February, 1979. Second moon. In the intervening month, Remus tried to retain a semblance of normality. He attended meetings and met his friends. Often he would go and see the girls on their lunch break, Lily and Marlene at St. Mungo's, Mary only a short bus trip away in Kensington. He phoned Grant if Sirius was away and he got lonely, and he listened to records and he read books. But he couldn't ignore how different he felt. Sometimes it caught him off guard. A memory would come to him or a scent, and his toes curled and he licked his teeth. His dreams became exclusively about forests and howling and cool, soft moonlight. He was better prepared the second time, just as nervous though. He apparated to the same spot as before, in case they came to meet him. But they didn't, and he transformed alone. The wolf found its pack even faster this time. They keened and yapped in greeting. The alpha bitch nipped his ear and rubbed herself against him. The younger wolves ducked their heads in submission. Then the hunt began. The wolf could not remember ever having felt such uncomplicated joy, even with its other pack. The rage and the fear and the hunger slipped away with the wind in its fur. The scent of the herd they stalked. When they finally caught up to the deer, Remus, Gaius, Livia, and Castor were the first in. They took down the stag. The others followed suit, closing in on the struggling beast. The wolf leapt and dug in its claws, relishing the panicked heartbeat of its prey. It sank in its teeth and tore away flesh, and hot, rich blood slid down its throat. When Remus woke up, he was not hungry. He allowed Livia to lick his wounds clean this time, too dopey and satisfied to think too hard about any of the implications.
"Will I meet Greyback next month?"
he asked, before Livia and Castor could melt back into the shadows.
"Our father is looking forward to meeting you, Remus Lupin,"
Livia said.
"You must be a little more patient, my brother."
"Have I proved myself?"
"It is not for us to decide."
He stayed in the forest longer than usual. perhaps just out of laziness. Even alone, he felt better there than he had anywhere else. He would have liked to curl up and sleep beneath the trees. When Remus finally reappeared outside the potter's back door, it was the middle of breakfast. Lily, James and Sirius were there, faces anxious and drawn, nursing large cups of milky tea. Mrs. Potter was standing at the window, peering out, and jumped when Remus arrived. She swung the door open.
"There you are!"
"I'm sorry,"
he murmured, a bit wobbly on his feet.
"Oh my gosh, Mooney, are you okay?"
Lily was at the door too now. She pointed at him, horrified. He looked down and saw the blood. It had trickled down his chin and neck, pooling in the hollow above his collarbones, and dried there, without him even noticing.
"Oh, shit."
He rubbed at his mouth self-consciously.
It's not mine. It's not."
James came to the door next, and Remus suddenly felt very queasy, covered in stag's blood, having feasted on deer only hours before. He stuck out an arm to lean against the wall, giddily.
"Come on, Mooney."
Sirius ducked between James and Lily and touched Remus's hand lightly.
"Let's get you cleaned up."
Gratefully, Remus allowed himself to be led upstairs to the bathroom. Sirius ran a warm bath, then stood leaning against the sink while Remus soaked himself, blinking dazedly at the rusted coloured swirls in the warm water.
It's not human,"
he said shakily.
"I know," Sirius said. "It's deer. I can smell it."
"You can?"
Remus looked up at him. Sirius wrinkled his nose. "I have to concentrate, but yeah. I was talking to Prongs about it. The longer we're Animagi, the more weird things we notice. Hope I don't go colourblind next year." Remus tried to laugh at this attempt to alleviate the tension, but he was too shaken up.
"Was it bad?"
Sirius asked gently, lowering his voice as if Remus was an invalid.
"No," Remus thought to himself. "It was wonderful. I was happy. I was normal." He was disgusted with himself. "What's happening to me?"
He looked at Sirius and nodded.
"Yeah, it was bad."
Tuesday, the 13th of March, 1979. Third moon.
"I don't want to go back to the Potters this time,"
Remus said, before he had to leave for the third moon with the pack.
"What?"
Sirius came out of the kitchen where he'd been doing the washing up. He was steadily becoming more house proud, or maybe it was just nervous energy. The war was hotting up for everyone, not just Remus. He was wearing a pair of bright yellow marigolds, which Remus had brought him as a joke, but he loved so much that he wore every time. They were wet and shining, dripping suds on the carpet.
"I said, I don't want to go back to the Potters," Remus repeated. "In the morning. You can stay there, obviously, but I just won't, okay? I don't know how safe it is. I don't want anyone to follow me."
"We've been fine so far."
Sirius had been doing that a lot, saying "we," when it was really only about Remus.
"I think we've been careless,"
Remus shrugged.
"I won't put them in danger again."
"Okay."
Sirius nodded. He peeled the gloves off slowly.
"Where do you want to go then?"
"I don't know. I thought maybe Cornwall. That castle ruin we visited. Do you remember?"
"Of course I remember. Shall I meet you there?"
"Wait for my signal. I want it to be safe."
Remus shifted from foot to foot. He wanted to pace. His back was aching again and he needed to go soon. But he kept still, in case Sirius worried.
"Oh, Mooney, even if it's not safe, then I'd rather be there so I can help. I know Prongs and Wormtail and Evans will too."
"No."
Remus raised his voice.
"No, please."
"But Mooney."
"Look, I have to go."
He practically flew out the door. He didn't even put on his coat. He hadn't said a proper goodbye. He hadn't even said "I love you," which they'd been doing every time they were separated, just in case. But of course,
Remus thought he was coming back. He couldn't have known what the pack had planned. This time, it was a relief to shed his human form and give up the responsibility for a few hours. They ran and played and fought and howled through the night, rustling fairies up from the underbrush, following scents they picked up. As the moon began to fade, the wolf slowed down, started to whimper as it felt its body shrinking back to its pathetic human form. The others stopped too and drew in close. Livia was the first to pounce, and Remus, half wolf, half man by this point, tried to struggle, but she held him fast, her paws becoming claw-like hands. Castor and Gaius had him too, pinning him down as Remus groaned and clenched his teeth through the pains of the transformation. And then he was human once more, pressed into the ground by the pack, braced against the tangle of strong and hot limbs. He raised his head, yelling, "What are you doing? Let me go!" Livia laughed astride him, throwing her head back, and then it happened. That weird sucking, squeezing sensation as all four of them apparated. Remus, helpless to do anything but cling on and pray he didn't get splinched. Suddenly, the ground beneath him was hard, cold stone, rocks digging into his bare back. The others finally got off him, and he scrambled to his feet, staring around wildly. They were indoors, in a high-ceilinged chamber, like a... was it a church? It was cold, and it reeked of the pack and ancient magic. The others stood around him, smiling madly. "Where the fuck am..." Remus started, but stopped short as Livia stepped to the side and a tall, dark figure approached. Remus knew that scent. He knew those burning yellow eyes. He froze, paralyzed by terror. Greyback stepped towards him, teeth bared in a cruel smile.
"Welcome home, cub."
End of chapter 157.